the bell icon on YouTube and don't miss another update.
I bring you this edition of Cut the Clutter from Bangalore. I'm traveling in Karnataka, watching the elections as you may have figured. But it's one of those editions of Cut the Clutter where I go away from politics and talk about something else. And today I talk about something that's worrying and weighing on the minds of very many of us. In fact, but for this politics, it would have been the top story, not just of the day, but of several days. That is the sudden and spectacular and dramatic collapse of Jet Airways. Without doubt, India's finest airline for a long time and very successful one, which has survived many near-death experiences, was a listed company, had great global franchise, great brand recognition and customer loyalty. So when I speak about Jet, do remember I must make a disclosure that I also have been a very persistent and loyal customer of Jet. I have trusted the airline for its safety, its punctuality, the quality of its service and the politeness and efficiency of its staff, and I do wish that the airline comes back because people who built that great franchise deserve much better. So what am I talking about? I'm talking about four reasons why airlines collapse in India, why fine airlines also collapse in India, and then maybe two or three reasons why Jet Airways itself specifically collapsed, and why family-run businesses or owner-run businesses always have a challenge, particularly in India. So first of all, the airline business. Now, airline business in India is not really, I mean, it's a bit of a paradox. The boom in India's private airline business and boom in Indian aviation has come as a result of economic reform of 1991. Yet, civil aviation stays one of the most unreformed sectors, one of the least reformed sectors. So here are the four reasons why airlines collapse in India. Number one, the regulatory mechanism for airlines, who will get what routes, how much capacity, what timings, is very non-transparent. A better way is to have a regulator, and you can call out the bids for routes, etc., etc., but that is not done. On the other hand, very many complicated conditions are laid, so many flights to northeastern areas, so many flights to backward areas. As things have turned out now, those areas are actually quite lucrative. So airlines don't need subsidies, don't need to be compelled to go there, as the Udaan scheme has now showed a great success. Airlines actually make more money going to those places. So to make other routes conditional on these takes away the marketing planning, the commercial planning away from the airlines, and the regulatory mechanism that is there is not transparent. There is too much discretion there in DGCA, in Ministry of Civil Aviation. So everybody is at the mercy of some civil servant, some politician, even some MP or some lobby. That's why private airline companies have customarily, for the past 25 years, since private airlines started, they have cultivated lobbies of politicians and even former bureaucrats. So that is one, poor regulation or lack of regulation, or I would say loaded regulation. So when an airline gets a bunch of routes, it's like a lottery. Why can't you just do it with a proper bidding mechanism or create more of a freedom of action? But for that, the second problem, under capacity. So there is, airline business is booming. It's partly booming because Indian railways are so poor. So people, I sometimes say in my lighter moments, but not really non-serious moments, when people ask me about the bullet train, I say that India already has a bullet train. It's called Indigo Airways, because that airline goes everywhere with a large number of seats and sells you tickets at a price which is today and which will continue to be lower than the price that bullet trains will cost you, simply because the capital cost of a bullet train is so high. So why do you ruin such a thing by creating under capacity? So you have over capacity, or you know, a sufficient capacity in the skies, but under capacity on the ground. So the two major airports of the country, the two major hubs of the country, Delhi and Bombay, both have this issue. Delhi, I'm surprised, because Delhi has three runways, but still sometimes you have to hang around Delhi for a long time, and there is some premium on slots in and out of Delhi. So a city like Delhi needs a second airport. The idea of an airport at Zewar across the river has been pending for a very long time. I'm glad that this is now seeing some movement, but again, building airports takes a long time. It will not be a functional, fully functional airport in less than 8 or 10 years. Second is Bombay, which is the biggest bottleneck for India. The most lucrative route in India is Delhi-Bombay. Just as in the US it might be New York-LA or New York-Washington, that's where the shuttles run. Bombay-Delhi, or from anywhere to Delhi and anywhere to Bombay, is the most lucrative route. But look at Bombay. Bombay Airport has such limited capacity that most airlines today would love to have more slots in Bombay, but they cannot. So Bombay's people traveling to Bombay are denied more capacity, and airlines can't fly more on their most lucrative route. And what is the reason? One of the reasons is that Bombay's second airport, which has been in the works for a very long time, the work has just barely begun there. And I do hope that that will move faster on the Navi Mumbai Airport, a very bright and very efficient woman IAS officer who I know well is in charge of the project. And I do hope this will move now, but the fact is that this will also take time. Until then, this more than sufficient capacity, unlimited capacity in the skies, and terrible under capacity, crippling under capacity on the ground in these key areas will continue to bedevil India's civil aviation business, because they cannot maximize their revenues and their profits. Third, somewhere in our bureaucratic mind and in our political economy, there is still an impression that civil aviation is a luxury business. That's why aviation fuel is taxed at a very high rate. Airports are allowed to charge very high landing and utilization fees. There is very high taxation on air tickets. So look what's happening. In fact, there was a tweet by Ashwini Lohani, who's run Air India well, and he's been from the railways, he knows service industry. And whatever my arguments with Air India, those are only because it's a government-run company in the service sector. But he makes a very good point that how can you have a situation where everybody involved with aviation is getting rich? So oil companies are getting rich, airport companies are getting rich, taxi operators are getting rich, hotel operators are getting rich, aircraft manufacturers are getting rich, caterers are getting rich. But who's getting poorer? The airline owners are getting poorer. So that is something that has to be corrected, and government is to blame there. Don't say that because your airports have become private, those guys are greedy and they are charging more. In all these private airports, government is an equal owner, Airport Authority of India, and for doing nothing, they get 50% revenue, and not a share of the profits, but share of revenues. The more the revenues, the more money. So this is a kind of indirect but brutal taxation that the government has imposed on the aviation business. So aviation fuel tax, then states put their own tax, then their tax on tickets, there is VAT, there is all kinds of taxes and all kinds of profiteering from civil aviation, all on the presumption that this is somehow a luxury business. So this is the fourth reason why we are really slaughtering the goose laying golden eggs. Now I will come to a few issues specific to Jet Airways and to owner-run companies. Naresh Goyal, who's a friend of mine who I've known for a long time, in fact, very few people who've been around in sort of public sphere this while would not have known him. He's a very charming man, a very generous friend, and a very open, accessible businessman. He built a great brand. His power is vision, entrepreneurship, and great networking. He can get almost anybody who matters in the aviation business anywhere in the world immediately on a speed dial, but at the same time, he can get many politicians, many film stars, many other influential people also similarly on call in no time. So this has worked very well for him because he's built a great airline, a great brand. He made sure that his standards were kept even higher than Singapore Airways and Lufthansa. But hubris catches up with people. Second, as you grow, a company has to move from an entrepreneurial phase to management phase. It is a well-known fact that many people who are great entrepreneurs or who are great visionaries are not great managers. I can tell you, even from my experience, having handled a large organization in a crisis where I was trusted by the owner to fix it in an entrepreneurial manner, I would say with luck, we had very good success doing that. But I also figured after a while that once the crisis was over and once the entrepreneurial part of the job was over, I wasn't the most suited person to manage it on day-to-day basis because the kind of motivation, the hormones, and actually the discipline that you need and self-control running a business which has already been set and is doing well is very different from being entrepreneurial, because an entrepreneurial person always has an itch. So that is something that Naresh Goyal should have done. He should have ceded to a good management team. Too many CEOs changed in his company. Too many people got fired. There was too much instability, and that was avoidable. And the next thing, when buyers were available, he should have cut his losses, because by now he was not only working for himself or fighting for himself, he was responsible for his employees, for his shareholders, for so many of their loyal customers. So he did not cut his losses on time. And third, the one fatal mistake that two big owners in India who set up very successful airlines made around the same time, in the go-go years of 2006, 2007, 2008, when money was sloshing all over the world just before the financial crisis. They both acquired large other airlines. So just as Kingfisher acquired Deccan Airways to keep up with the Malyas, Naresh Goyal also acquired Sahara. Those two were very expensive and very wasteful acquisitions. I would say those were driven not by vision, those were driven part by vanity, part by insecurity, that what happens if my rival gets so much more market share. Both were stupid decisions. Both decisions were made at a time when a lot of money was available. Companies had IPOs. That money could have been used to build future businesses around the brands they had. But buying this market share at a high price is something. So both these companies are a case of businessmen who swallowed such a big bite that they've still not been able to digest it. And frankly, that indigestion has taken both the companies down. And I say this with the sobering reminder that I speak from the city of Kingfisher, Bangalore, and around me are banners of Royal Challengers Bangalore, which was a company also set up by Kingfisher, again in those same go-go times. So these are the many lessons from the collapse of Jet Airways that everybody needs to learn. And I do hope that given the fact that Jet Airways is still a strong brand, has a lot of customer loyalty and great employees, it finds a buyer soon enough and is back in the skies. So until then, my best wishes to the employees of Jet Airways.